Good evening, everyone. My name is Professor Andy Nisbet. I'm the current head of the Medical Physics and Biomedical Engineering Department here at University College London. It's a real pleasure to welcome everyone to Professor Karin Shmueli's inaugural lecture. We're delighted to welcome so many of Karin's families and friends to this event, as well as colleagues past and present. Just a couple of shout-outs. We're delighted that Professor Shmueli's PhD supervisor, Professor Roger Orridge, who was the Joel Professor, which was one of the first professorships in medical physics awarded worldwide. So Professor Orridge wasn't the first professor of Joel Professor, but held the post in the department for a number of years and was Karin's PhD supervisor. We also welcome Dr. Donald McRobbie, who was Karin's NHS Medical Physics Training Supervisor. Both Donald and Roger have travelled from Australia, so thank you. And also we have Mrs. Tessa Cox, who was Karin's high school physics teacher. So. So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Shmueli. So I've made a few notes just to make sure that I get my facts correct. So Professor Shmueli was appointed Professor of Magnetic Resonance Imaging Physics on the 1st of October 2021 in recognition of outstanding world-leading contributions to MRI physics. Professor Shmueli's global reputation is reflected in many invitations to present at major international conferences, including a very recent invitation to deliver a historical fireside chat on moments in susceptibility imaging history at the 2024 annual meeting of the world's foremost MRI conference, which was ISMRM, which was held in Singapore just a few weeks ago. Professor Shmueli's international esteem is also evidenced in her contributions to international recommendations, such as co-authorship of a quantitative susceptibility mapping consensus paper published in January of this year on recommended implementation of QSM for clinical research in the brain, a consensus of the ISRM electromagnetic tissue properties study group, and we'll learn all about QSM over the course of Professor Shmueli's lecture. Professor Shmueli's work has also been included amongst the 100 classic contributions that have transformed how MRI is used today. And this is work that Karin presented in the footprints of the ISMRM on the MRI path at the 2022 annual meeting of the ISMRM in London. Professor Shmueli has also been very successful in obtaining grant funding. She currently holds a significant European Research Council Consolidator Grant, and amongst a number of other grants, she's a primary contributor to a £29 million award for a national facility for ultra-high field human MRI scanning. Professor Shmueli has published approximately 50 peer-reviewed publications and over 100 peer-reviewed abstracts, which have collectively been cited over 4,000 times. However, it's not just in research that Professor Shmueli excels, as she has a number of outstanding and inspirational teaching nominations and awards, which I hope makes Mrs. Cox very pleased that she's forwarded your footsteps. Professor Shmueli is also Programme Director of our intercalated BSc, Bachelor of Science in Medical Physics and Biomedical Engineering, which is taken by third year medical students and a very successful programme. Karin's student feedback is consistently excellent and frequently includes such phrases as difficult and complicated material made accessible. And on that note, it is my absolute pleasure to invite Professor Shmueli to deliver an inaugural lecture.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Nisbet, for that very kind introduction. And thank you so much for all being here this evening. It's really quite overwhelming, and it's really great to have all the people on Zoom as well. So really, really happy that they've joined us. And even though I can't see them, I feel them in the room here with me. So welcome to my inaugural lecture, A Magnetic Journey, Optimizing MRI Mapping of Tissue Electromagnetic Properties for Clinical Applications. So this is where my journey started with my family. you can see my parents, my sister, me with my parents, me with my my grandparents, my father's parents, and my mum's parents, my other grandparents. And so that's where my overall journey started. But I'm going to tell you about my magnetic journey. So I'm going to tell you about how I got from school magnets, messing around with school magnets. You may have done this experiment where you sprinkle iron filings around a magnet and see the magnetic field lines, to creating beautiful and hopefully clinically useful magnetic resonance images like the ones you see here. And we're all sitting in the Earth's magnetic field strength, in the Earth's magnetic field right now, which has a field strength of about 50 millionths of a Tesla. A Tesla is the unit of magnetic field strength, named after the Croatian physicist. And that's the field that turns a compass needle. And this bar magnet is probably about 200 times the strength of the Earth's magnetic field. And the magnet that created, that allowed us to create these images is 3 Tesla, has a magnetic field strength of 3 Tesla. And that's about 60,000 times the strength of the Earth's magnetic field. So we need these really strong magnets to create these images. So I'm going to take you on my magnetic journey today. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my career journey, and in parallel, tell you a little bit about the story of some of my science, just some highlights. Really, hopefully, you'll understand why I'm doing all of this. And it's really to try and optimize MRI to give new information that's hopefully of clinical use with high resolution and in a short scan time, so that patients are comfortable and don't have to spend ages in the MRI scanner, and so that we can save time and money. Okay, so it all started, again, with my NHS medical physics training. So I studied physics, natural sciences and physics at Cambridge, and I was intrigued by the physics, but I really wanted to do something to help people. So I went and trained to become a medical physicist in the National Health Service, and I trained in nuclear medicine, ultrasound, and of course MRI, and I'm very happy that two of my training supervisors are here this evening, Danny McCool, who supervised me for nuclear medicine, and Dr. Donald McRobbie, who supervised me for MRI. And Donald has written this book, which I still use to teach my students, and I highly recommend for anyone who wants to find out more details about MRI. And I was also very happy to be trained with Dr. Rebecca Quest and Dr. Annie Papadaki, who's also here this evening. And the field strength of the MRI scanners that we were using at the time were 1.5 Tesla, so about 30,000 times the strength of the Earth's magnetic field. So I just, forgive me, MRI experts in the room, but I'm just going to remind people what MRI is. So as Professor Nisbet said, it stands for magnetic resonance imaging. And the magnetic part is that we have this very strong superconducting magnet that creates a very, very strong magnetic field through the bore, through the center of the magnet. It's very strong, it's very uniform. And that's there to create this tiny signal, which originates from the nuclei in the hydrogen atoms in all the water molecules of which we are mostly made. And so that's this tiny little signal, which again acts like the bar magnet of a compass needle. So it's this tiny little bar magnet that we're trying to measure. And we can't measure it while it's lined up with the main magnetic field, because that's so strong and it's so tiny. So what we need to do is we need to tip it away from the main magnetic field. And we do that using radio waves. And the reason we do it using radio waves is that, as well as lining up with the main magnetic field, this tiny little signal is also rotating around. And so, and it's rotating millions of times a second at radio frequencies. So we need to use radio waves to inject energy to excite that signal and for us to be able to detect it. And so that's what this bar magnet looks like once it's been tipped away from the main magnetic field and gives us this little signal that we can detect over here. And then we have the imaging part where we turn that signal into these beautiful images at very high resolution that are useful to doctors, hopefully, and neuroscientists and many others. So that's MRI. So my next step in MRI was to do a PhD here at UCL in this department. And this was with, as you've heard, supervised with Professor Roger Ordidge. And I was very lucky to work on a 4.7 Tesla magnet, which at the time was the highest field strength human MRI scanner in Europe. And why did we want to work at high magnetic field strengths? Well, this is because the higher field strengths give us more of that tiny little signal that we can then use to either scan faster or to see finer details. And you can see some of the finer details if you look carefully here. You can see some spaces around the blood vessels. They're called Virchow-Robin spaces. And if we zoom in, you can also see some hair follicles sticking out of the scalp, which gives you an idea of some of the scale of the details that we could see with the images from this scanner. So I'm going to show you some pictures of some highlights from my PhD. This was the official opening of the Wellcome Trust High Field Lab. And we've got all the people who helped me get my PhD here, including Dr. Dave Thomas, who's also here tonight, Harry Parks here, Professor David Carmichael, Dr. Enrico De Vita, and Dr. Paul Kinchesh, and of course, the guest of honor. And I promise you, we didn't coordinate on what color to wear that day. But I also think that Roger was probably more proud of the fact that this glass brain could light up than some of the images we were acquiring at the time. But we had great fun, and that was one of the highlights, a very special day. Another highlight was winning this student poster competition, which was all about me trying to overcome something called susceptibility artifacts. So what are susceptibility artifacts and what was I doing? I was making something called a phantom, which is a mimic of the head that was trying to mimic these errors that we have in our images, which we call artifacts, which in this case are called geometric distortion and dropout, so stretching and squashing of the signal, or it disappearing altogether, so dropout. And it was caused by these differences in something called susceptibility between air and tissue. So what is magnetic susceptibility? Well, it's an electromagnetic property of tissues. It's a property of materials, and it tells us how they're going to behave when we put them inside this very, very strong magnetic field that's inside our MRI scanner. So here's a spectrum of susceptibility values for different kinds of tissues. And what you can see is that we can look at these values relative to the susceptibility of soft tissue, which is pretty much a susceptibility of water because we're very watery. And what happens is if you have a susceptibility that's less than this value, it's lower, then we call it diamagnetic or negative. And what it does is it pushes away the magnetic field lines. So there's a weaker magnetic field inside an object with a lower susceptibility. So it disturbs the magnetic field. And similarly, objects that are paramagnetic or tissues that are paramagnetic, like deoxygenated blood, concentrate the field lines inside them and increase the field. So we can see that the susceptibility disturbs the magnetic field. And I'm going to show you that we can actually calculate how the susceptibility disturbs the field. So if we knew the susceptibility distribution inside tissue, then we could do a pretty simple calculation that involves this dipole, this cloverleaf-shaped field, and we could calculate what the field perturbation looks like. And the main thing to notice about this pattern of field differences in the head is that it's dominated by the susceptibility difference between the air and the tissue. And here you can see the higher fields around those air spaces. The other thing to notice is that the susceptibility has a larger effect when we're at higher or stronger magnetic fields. So that inspired my next career choice, which was to go and work as a postdoc at the National Institutes of Health. And the key, one of the key achievements that I made there was to turn susceptibility from something that we were worrying about, susceptibility artifacts, to seeing how we could actually exploit it and create useful images and create gain useful information from it. So I went from working at almost 100,000 times the Earth's magnetic field across the Atlantic to work at 7 Tesla, so almost 140,000 times the field that we're sitting in now. And you can see the magnet being installed in about 2002. It was one of the first 3 magnets, 7 Tesla human magnets in the world. I was working with Jeff Dunn in the National Institute for Neurological Disorders and Stroke, part of the NIH. So why did we want to go to an even higher magnetic field strength? So again, it's because we get more of that tiny signal, and we can trade that in to either scan faster or at higher resolution and see finer details. The other thing that we mentioned just before is that it means we have more sensitivity to these susceptibility differences. And in fact, soon after I arrived, that meant that we were able to acquire these beautiful, phase images here. And again, you can see that these are very, very fine, detailed, high-resolution images at 0.24 by 0.24 by 1 millimetre. And you can start to see cortical layers in the back of the brain here. You can start to see stripes in the cortex. This is called the stripe of Jannari. You can see these really fine blood vessels in the centre of the brain here, and lots of white matter tracts and all sorts of beautiful structure. But, I hear you ask, what are these phase images? What is phase in MRI? So phase is part of the signal that we measure in MRI that's normally thrown away. Most MRI images, most sequences and scanners don't even bother to save the phase images. And so most of the time when we're looking, this is now looking down into that plane where that tiny, tiny signal has been tipped away from the main magnetic field. And it's going round and round and round at radio frequencies. Obviously, I'm not going to go round that fast. But we're looking down into that plane. We can see that tiny signal. And most of the time, we're just measuring the length of that arrow, the length of that vector, the strength of that signal to create our images. But with phase, we're actually imaging the angle by which this little tiny bar magnet has rotated at the time that we acquire our image. So that is the definition of phase in MRI. And this is a phase image. We can create an image from that phase as well. So the other thing to notice, to know about these phase images is that they are directly proportional to the strength of those field disturbances. So they depend on the field perturbations. And the other thing that you might see is that there are these jumps in the phase image here. It goes from dark to bright. And that's because the phase is this angle that goes round and round. So it starts off at 0 degrees, goes all the way around to 360 degrees, and then jumps down to zero again. And that's why we get these jumps or wraps in the phase image. So we know that susceptibility affects the magnetic field and disturbs it. And now we know, because we know that the phase images are proportional to the field disturbances, we can see that we can actually use phase images, that these are related to the susceptibility distribution inside our head. So that means that the phase images we saw were related to the susceptibility distribution of tissues. And so we might think, okay, we've done what we achieved. We've got some kind of images that are related to the susceptibility distribution. But alas, we could not stop there, because phase images have a couple of disadvantages, major disadvantages. One of the disadvantages is that if we look at this cortical layer now in the surface of a piece of preserved or fixed human brain tissue, we can see that it has very different contrast. So when it's running parallel to the main magnetic field, it looks bright. And when it's running perpendicular to the main field, it looks dark. And so it's not very useful if it's the same kind of tissue that it looks totally different depending on what its orientation is. We can also see the same effect in this rat brain here with the white matter changing its contrast depending on how it's oriented with respect to the main magnetic field here. And so this is a disadvantage of orientation dependence. The other disadvantage of phase images is that the contrast in these images kind of leaks out or stretches out beyond the structures that cause that change. So here you can see a couple of structures in the center of the brain where the phase changes are actually occurring outside of those structures. So if we were trying to localize those structures in a phase image, we would put them in the wrong place. So that's another problem. That's the contrast being non-local. So those are the two major disadvantages of phase images. So at the NIH, we developed a method to overcome those disadvantages and calculate susceptibility maps from those phase images. So I'm going to describe briefly the steps in that susceptibility mapping process. So first, we had to acquire the right kind of magnetic resonance images, which happen to be called T2-star weighted gradient echo images. And again, here you can see the phase images with those phase jumps, those phase wraps that I mentioned. So we want to get rid of those wraps because we don't want to have those in our images as well. And which I always tell everyone is that we must save the phase. We must not throw it away, otherwise we can't do anything. And then we have to do this phase unwrapping procedure. And there are many, many algorithms now out there to do this. As Professor Nisbet said at the beginning, we've now, as a community, kind of come together and decided which kinds of algorithms we should use. But there are a whole sea of them out there. There weren't at the time. And now you can see in this unwrapped phase image that the contrast is dominated by the difference between the susceptibility in the air spaces and the tissue susceptibility. And we're not really interested in just seeing that big difference between tissue and air. We're interested in the more subtle susceptibility differences inside the different structures in the brain. So we want to get rid of these so-called background fields. And we have many other ways, we have many algorithms, again, that can remove those background field variations and reveal the more subtle field differences underneath. Now there's more of a consensus about which kinds of methods might be best. And finally, we can calculate the susceptibility from these local field maps and overcome those disadvantages of the non-local contrast and the orientation-dependent contrast by solving the inverse problem. Why is it called an inverse problem? Because as we saw before, it's relatively easy to calculate the phase images if we knew what the susceptibility distribution would be. But now we have to go backwards from the phase image that we measure and calculate the susceptibility image, that's the susceptibility distribution that's underneath it all. So that's called the inverse problem. So here are some of the first susceptibility maps from a living human being acquired at 7 Tesla at the NIH. And what you can see here is that the susceptibility maps overcome that non-local contrast that I showed you before. So now you can see that these structures are bright and that the contrast doesn't leak too much out of those structures. And so we can see that susceptibility mapping seems to overcome that problem of the non-local contrast. It also overcomes the orientation dependence that we saw. So if you look carefully at this piece of fixed brain tissue acquired at two different orientations with respect to the main magnetic field. So we rotated the tissue in the field. I've just lined them up here so you can compare them visually. You can see the fantastic contrast that pops out in the phase image, where you can see structures that you couldn't even see in some of the conventional images, like these white matter fibers and these layers in the cortex. But if you compare the top row with the bottom row, you can see that these phase images have almost opposite contrast. Whereas if you look at the susceptibility map, they look very, very similar. And so here's a profile that we've plotted of the phase image, where the contrast is almost opposite, and a profile in the susceptibility map, where the contrast is almost identical. So that just shows that the susceptibility mapping overcomes this orientation dependence. And as Professor Nisbet very kindly mentioned, this work was recognised as a classic contribution, a new MR method, tool and application that greatly impacted and transformed how MR is used today, and which has become a classic contribution. And I presented that in 2008 at the ICMRM, that's the International Society for Magnetic Resonance in Medicine. That meeting was held in Toronto. And was very happy to have that recognised. And that work was then published, and that paper's been cited about over 650 times nowadays. And this kind of shows that it was part of the birth of this field. And the field has now been named quantitative susceptibility mapping, because QSM is a little bit easier to say than susceptibility mapping. So that's what it's called these days. And this is the number of papers in QSM over the years. So, coming back to UCL, I was attracted back to UCL, and why did I come back? I wanted to use this new method that we had developed and optimize it for clinical applications. So I left the very high field strength magnets that were always available for research, and this is the group just before I left, flew back across the Atlantic and came down to working at a mere 3 Tesla and 1.5 Tesla in hospital scanners that didn't really necessarily have, I had to apply for the research time. But I did that to work with clinicians and try to help them see if these methods could help them solve their clinical problems. So what kind of problems might we be inspired, or what kind of things could we solve using susceptibility mapping? So why do we want to use this method? Why do we think it might be useful for solving clinical problems? And the answer is that the magnetic susceptibility depends on what's in the tissue, so all the molecules and all the chemicals that are in the tissue. And so that means that if we think about what kinds of what makes up the tissue, then we might be we can see what kind of clinical applications would be inspired by that. So, for example, in the brain and in the liver, there's iron that's stored in the tissue in the form of ferritin, this ferritin protein. And that means that we could perhaps use QSM for targeting brain structures for deep brain stimulation for severe depression or movement disorders. We could also look at iron accumulation in these neurodegenerative diseases like multiple sclerosis or sickle cell anemia. Deoxyhemoglobin, which is deoxygenated blood, is very strongly paramagnetic. And you can see there's this very nice linear relationship between the susceptibility and the concentration of deoxyhemoglobin, so basically how deoxygenated the blood is. So that suggests that we could use this to look at bright veins, which are deoxygenated. We could look at hemorrhages, microbleeds. We might even be able to study brain function, where the oxygenation changes in the brain. We could use, we know that myelin is mildly diamagnetic, so we could potentially look at demyelinating diseases like multiple sclerosis. And calcifications are very strongly diamagnetic, and inflammation also changes the susceptibility of tissue, so we could perhaps look at prostate cancer, calcifications, epilepsy, arthritis, and many, many more. But these are just some of the ideas that we had. So I needed to build a group of people to help me do this research, and this is one of the earliest pictures of my group. And here you can see there's mostly, as well as the PhD students, there's master students and undergraduate project students. And I'm very grateful to the department for providing these students throughout the 12 years that I've been back in the department as an academic. And this was my first set of PhD students. I'm very grateful, again, to the department for providing funding for some of those, and also to the Center for Doctoral Training in Medical Imaging for funding their PhDs. So before we could apply these QSM techniques to clinical images, we needed to optimize them technically. And the title of the lecture was Optimizing MRI Mapping of Tissue Electromagnetic Properties for Clinical Applications. And I'm just going to spend a little bit of time talking about 4 applications of QSM, so just focusing on susceptibility. And these are just some of the papers that we published during to optimize these techniques, so the technical developments that we made so that we could apply these techniques clinically. So I'm going to talk about one application, which is using susceptibility mapping to look at microbleeds. These are tiny, tiny bleeds in the brain. And one advantage of susceptibility mapping is if we look at this magnitude image, you see these two blobs. And so they look the same. We don't know what they are, what's inside them. But if we look at the susceptibility map, we can see that there's one very dark blob, most likely a diamagnetic calcification, and one bright blob, which is most likely a paramagnetic bleed. So this is a very useful feature of susceptibility mapping, that it can allow us to discriminate between positive and negative susceptibilities. And this is an example of a QSM in a patient with cerebral amyloid angiopathy, so a buildup of this pathological amyloid protein in the blood vessels that causes them to bleed and become leaky. And this is the group at the time with my first postdoc, Barbara Demerska. And what you can see on the left is something called a susceptibility-weighted image, which is actually a filtered phase image multiplied by the conventional magnitude image to amplify any phase changes in that image. And you can see that there are lots of apparent bleeds and sort of larger hemorrhages and smaller microbleeds. And if you look at the susceptibility map, then you can see the same kind of bright bleeds. But if you look very carefully now at these red arrows, you can see that some of them are pointing to some dark blobs that aren't there in the susceptibility map. Okay, they don't appear in that susceptibility map. And that's because of this non-local contrast, some of those bleeds might not actually be there. There might be sort of extra bleeds that look like they're in more slices than they actually are. And so we think that we can resolve these apparent additional microbleeds by using susceptibility mapping. So, for example, you might count a bleed in this slice, if you've got a slice over here, and another bleed in this slice in the phase or SWI image, whereas in the susceptibility image, you'd only count that bleed once. And why is it important? It's because microbleed counts can be used to stage some clinical diseases like CAA, like this cerebral amyloid angiopathy. And this work is actually ongoing, trying to see if we can quantify this effect with Professor David Waring, David Thomas, Barbara Demerska, and others. So, just something I wanted to mention about acquiring these images for QSM is that it's super efficient. It gives you loads of information that you can use. So, if we save the magnitude and the phase data, then we get our standard magnitude image, and we also get our phase image. And we can, if we acquire the image at several different echo times, then we can fit the signal decay over those echo times and create a map of this MRI parameter called R2 star, which tells us about the microscopic field differences in the tissue. We can also do this susceptibility-weighted imaging that I just described, where we can, and this is very widespread clinically. Radiologists are very used to looking at SWI images, so that's quite common out there. And of course, we can calculate our susceptibility maps. So we get lots and lots of information from these single short scans. And here's the group in February 2020 with the newer members. So a new PhD student, Oliver Kiesnowski, and another postdoc, Dr. Carlos Milovic, who joined us from Chile. This is now an application of susceptibility mapping that is outside the brain. So here we're looking at the sacroiliac joint in an inflammatory disease called spondyloarthritis. And this involves the spine, the lower limb joints, and this, we really, in standard images, it was very hard to see if the bone marrow was losing, or if the bone was losing mineral density, if the bone marrow was being replaced by fat in fat metaplasia, or if there was swelling. So we wondered whether susceptibility mapping could tell us about these processes. And in fact, if we look at the susceptibility maps here in this left column, and you can see the standard images on the right, and what we found differences, significant differences between the susceptibility in these regions of bone marrow that were being infiltrated and replaced by fat. And we also found, by using, again, a mimic with some added fat and some added ground-up bone particles, that we could use susceptibility mapping to quantify how much of the susceptibility was from the fat and how much was from the bone minerals. And so that means that we could potentially use QSM as a measure of bone mineral density, which could help in monitoring, in diagnosing and in monitoring progress and treatments of this spondyloarthritis. And that was work with Tim Bray and my PhD student, Anita Carter. So this is the group in October 2020. You all know very well why we're in these Teams boxes. We had several people starting in the group during the pandemic, which was very tricky, but they're all still with us today, so that's really great. So we had two new PhD students, Jeanette Nassar and Oriana Arsenov, and two new postdocs, Dr. Lakshmi Muralidharan and Dr. Patrick Fuchs. We came through it. So we had weekly kind of chat meetings to keep our spirits up. And I was also very happy to receive in December 2020 a copy of this book, a hard copy in the post. That was because I'd been invited to write this chapter on QSM. So that was a nice treat. And here in December 2021, the expanded outdoor group photo. You can tell the progress of the pandemic by how close we are to each other. New starter in this photo was PhD student Mitchell Lee. I'm very excited to talk about applying QSM in sickle cell anemia. So just to tell you a little bit about sickle cell anemia, this is a genetic disorder that affects the hemoglobin molecule, which is the molecule that carries oxygen inside our red blood cells. And in sickle cell anemia, these change to this abnormal sickle shape when they're deoxygenated. And that means that they can't deliver enough oxygen to the tissues. Many more blood cells die, and people suffer from many different symptoms like blocked blood vessels and bleeds, strokes, and cognitive difficulties. We wanted to see, we know that brain iron is important in cognition, and we know that people with sickle cell anemia have cognitive difficulties, so we wanted, and also that iron overload might accelerate neurodegeneration. And we know that susceptibility values reflect iron content in tissue, so we wanted to see what was going on in the brains of these people with sickle cell anemia in terms of their iron content, and also look at their blood deoxygenation, because perhaps their blood is not as oxygenated as it should be. And so we used QSM to investigate whether sickle cell anemia is affecting brain iron levels and oxygenation. And this work has been done, has been inspired by Professor Fenella Kirkham, who's also here this evening, who's a paediatric neurologist and a sickle cell anemia expert. And she's been an absolute inspiration and a pleasure to collaborate with all these years. And through her, we've collaborated on studies done both in Tanzania and here in the UK. And this is Dr. Mboka Jacob from the Muhimbili National Hospital. She's a neurologist there and in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. And she's one of our collaborators. And a lot of this work was done by Dr. Russell Murdoch. And the people in the group now who are working on this are Mitchell Lee and Dr. Matthew Cherukara. So this is looking in the brain to see if brain iron accumulation, if we can look at brain iron changes in sickle cell anemia. And what we did was we used QSM to look at every single voxel in the brains of about 88 people with sickle cell anemia and compared them with about 30 healthy controls. And what you can see in the yellowy, orangey, red colours are places in the brain where the people with sickle cell anemia had increased susceptibility compared to the healthy controls. And the blue blobs are where they had a lower susceptibility. And so you can see that there are quite a few regions in the brain where there's increased susceptibility, particularly in these deep brain grey matter nuclei here. And so that suggested that there was an increase in the iron content in these regions. This was corroborated by actually drawing regions of interest in these regions and having a look at what happens to the susceptibility inside them. And what's interesting is that you actually get a faster increase in susceptibility with age in sickle cell anemia than you do in healthy controls. So this tells us that there's changes in iron metabolism in sickle cell anemia, and we're continuing to investigate how this might be useful to tell us about the pathophysiology and what's going on. The other thing we looked at was brain oxygenation in these people. And we drew a region in the largest vein in the brain, which is the superior sagittal sinus that runs all the way down the back of our brain. You can see that region here. We measured the susceptibility inside it, again, in the same group of people. And what you can see is that there's indeed a lower oxygenation overall in that vein in people with sickle cell anemia. And this actually gets worse if they have something called a silent cerebral infarct, which is another lesion that you can see on a standard MRI. So this is telling us that their physiology is really, really different, really altered, and we could perhaps use this to monitor potential treatments for people with sickle cell anemia in the future. And I know Fenella has lots of drugs trials that she wants to do, so hopefully something that's a really useful measure. This is the group in May 2022 at the London annual meeting of the ISMRM. And I was very proud that Dr. Carlos Milovic was awarded the junior fellowship of the ISMRM at that meeting. The last clinical application that I'm going to talk about, I've been very happy to work with Professor Ramona Weil and Professor Mina Wrighton. They are experts in Parkinson's disease and for Ramona, and clinical genetics for Mina. They're also very good friends, which it's been a pleasure to collaborate with them. And it was really a privilege to join in with this study, which was really their idea. And this was done by George Thomas, who's also here. It's lovely to have you here, Ramona and George. And what we wanted to ask were, why are particular regions of the brain more affected by neurodegeneration in Parkinson's disease? And so we wanted to see if QSM could answer that question. So we were looking for relationships between QSM changes, so susceptibility changes in Parkinson's disease, and gene expression in healthy brains from a database of gene expression in healthy brains in the same regions. And I think this is the first study to combine susceptibility mapping with gene expression information. So I think it's really exciting. And they did lots of very clever things. There were about 97 Parkinson's disease patients and 35 healthy controls. And in all these brain regions, the susceptibility was mapped. And similarly, there's this healthy database of many genes being expressed, almost 16,000 genes. That's the Allen brain database. And we correlated the gene expression with the susceptibility mapping in the same regions. And then we used gene ontology, which basically is a bit like a dictionary to tell you what kinds of biological processes are going on in those regions that were correlated with the increases in susceptibility in people with Parkinson's disease. So this was a really, really clever study. These are the results. You can see the correlation between the susceptibility maps and the gene expression. And what the gene ontology told us was then that the regional susceptibility increases in Parkinson's are associated, indeed, with specific gene expression profiles. And in those regions where there are correlations, the kinds of genes that are expressed relate to heavy metal processing, so detoxification of heavy metals, like maybe iron, copper, etc., things that perhaps we can see with QSM, and also synaptic signaling, so that's nerve firing and nerve functioning. And this really tells us about the kinds of processes that might be driving the neurodegeneration in Parkinson's and why those regions might be more vulnerable. And it also, again, could be useful for suggesting future targets for potential treatments to slow the progression of Parkinson's. So, further research at UCL, I wanted to see, can we get even more information from the phase images that we're acquiring to calculate these susceptibility maps. So this is the group in March 2023 with new joiners, Dr. Jirung Luo and Dr. Matthew Cherukara. And we wanted to see if we could use that phase information to calculate something, to get even more information out of it. So if you remember before, we know that the phase has a component that's proportional to the field changes, and that's how we calculate the magnetic susceptibility. But there's also this other part of the phase information, which is the phase at zero echo time, which can give us electrical properties information. So we can use this part of the phrase, we can extrapolate the phase to zero echo time or use techniques that give us that phase. And we can do this calculation called electrical properties tomography, which I'm not going to go into detail about. But what it gives us is the electrical conductivity in the tissue. And it's not the conductivity that we'd get if we just ran a direct current through our brain tissue. It's actually the high-frequency electrical conductivity. And that's because, if you remember, MRI is happening at these radio frequencies, so very, very high frequencies. And so the ions don't really move very, very far because they're oscillating very fast. And so the conductivity that we measure depends on the ion concentration, so the concentration of physiologically interesting ions like sodium, potassium, calcium. And so perhaps we can find out about the electrical properties of the tissue at these high frequencies. And these are the kinds of maps that we can generate, conductivity maps, high-frequency conductivity maps, from our phase data, the same phase images that we acquire for our QSM. And in the past, conductivity mapping has been used to look at brain tumours that have an increased conductivity compared to normal tissue. And what we are planning to do is, we're starting to do, is to optimise conductivity mapping and apply it for many of the clinical applications that I've shown you and many more, so that we can actually squeeze in even more information out of the data that we've already got and that we've already calculated susceptibility maps for. So, one more piece of information that we can squeeze out of our data is something called functional MRI. This is where we actually apply a stimulus to humans, like, for example, this visual stimulus here. If we apply this checkerboard flashing at 8 hertz, then our brains are going to fire, our visual cortices are going to fire, we're going to have neuronal activation, the blood vessels are going to dilate, and in fact we have this phenomenon where they oversupply oxygenated blood to the region that's active, which overcompensates for the metabolic demand, and that means that the concentration of deoxyhemoglobin actually goes down, and we know then that the susceptibility will go down, and that gives us then a change in the signal that we measure, the magnitude of the signal. And if we acquire lots and lots of images throughout the time that we have these on and off flashing checkerboards and do lots of statistics on the signal in those images, we can create these functional MRI maps, and we can see regions where the brain is active during this stimulus. So this is a visual activation map, and we can see that the signal in this most activated voxel goes up and down as the stimulus is turned on and off. Now, if we think about what's underlying this functional MRI is actually blood oxygenation level dependent contrast, bold contrast. So it's the change in the susceptibility, actually, that's driving this. And so what we can do is we can actually use QSM to detect that susceptibility decrease much more directly. So instead of looking at the downstream magnitude signal, we can look at the susceptibility maps during this activation process, and that should give us more localized results. And you can see that here in this so-called functional QSM map, where you can see that the activated regions are smaller. They're also weaker, perhaps because of more physiological noise coming in. But you can see that the susceptibility decreases when the checkerboard is on and increases when it's off, and so on. So this is another technique that's been used. And what we wanted to do, we now know, or hopefully you now know, that QSM, electrical properties tomography, and functional MRI all are very useful and show a lot of promise for characterizing neurodegenerative diseases. But if we were to do each of these experiments separately, then it would mean that the poor patient or volunteer would be stuck in the scanner for ages, and we don't want that. So what we've done is we've developed a very fast scan to acquire all of these things simultaneously. So simultaneous structural and functional susceptibility maps, conductivity maps, and functional information. And we wanted to do this again to make clinical studies more comfortable and to see if we can develop markers of different diseases. So what we've done is we have a sequence that takes about 5 minutes and 20 seconds, or just under 5.5 minutes, to acquire 70 rapid whole brain images to allow us to look at brain function. Each of those takes about 4 seconds, and we're looking at voxels that are 1.3 millimeters cubed, so we still maintain our fine detail. And this work was funded by the European Research Council by my consolidator grant that we've still got work to do. But what this gives us is this fantastic array of multimodal information. This is all from this 5.5 minute scan. And what we have is we have our standard magnitude image. We have our standard functional MRI image. And fMRI has been the bread and butter of neuroscience for about the last 30 years. So it's really good to have that. We have this R2 star map, which is this MRI parameter that tells us about the microscopic field differences. We've got the SWI that clinicians like to look at. We've got our susceptibility maps that we've seen how useful they can be to tell us about the tissue composition. We've now got this new functional quantitative susceptibility mapping, which we can see is more localized than the standard fMRI, again, in this visual activation experiment. And we've got our electrical conductivity maps, which give us very different information as well. And we can also apply the same kind of approach to obtain function, to look at functional changes in electrical conductivity. So how is that electrical conductivity changing maybe when our brains are active? So this is very new and exciting, and we're excited to explore this further. So I hope I've taken you on a journey through my career and just some highlights from my scientific story. And this is where I have to try not to cry. I'd like to thank all my current and former colleagues, current and former lab members, so everyone who's in this picture and everyone who's come before them as well, who I've shown you throughout the talk, for all their hard work. Really, so happy to work with you all. I'd like to thank all my funders through the 12 years that I've been back at UCL. So there's a few of them there. I'd like to thank my collaborators, and these are just the people that I've worked with, some of the people that I've worked with in the last 12 years at UCL. I know that there are people I've missed off this slide, and I'm still thanking you. So please forgive me if your name does not appear here, but I'm very, very grateful. None of this work could happen if it wasn't for these multidisciplinary teams of clinicians and physicists and research radiographers. I'd like to thank all the volunteers who volunteered for all the clinical studies, all the clinical data that we find so valuable. I'd like to thank all my departmental colleagues, both in the department, also the professional services staff. I'd like to thank Naomi for organising today so beautifully. I'd like to thank the international electromagnetic tissue properties research community, so mostly around the ISMRM, but also beyond, who we wrote the consensus paper with and who we've collaborated with. I'd like to thank... I'd like to thank Miss Juliet King and Dr. Robin Howard, without whose surgical and clinical skills and care, I would not be standing in front of you today. I'd like to thank all my mentors throughout my time at UCL. So I'd like to thank Danny Alexander, Jem Hebden, Paul Beard, Adrian Desjardins, Claire Elwell, many others who've mentored me. throughout my time here. And I'd like to thank my family. I can't look at my mum because he's crying as well. I'd like to thank my mum, who's been a source of unwavering love and support throughout everything, and she's always been there for me. And all my family, and all my family who I know are watching online in Israel. It really means so much to me that you're here with me. And I'd like to finally, last but not least, thank my husband and my daughter. Without your love and support, it just wouldn't be worthwhile. You make it all possible. You're always here for me, and you make it all worth it. So thank you so much for coming along and for being quiet throughout the whole thing. Really proud of you. And finally, I'd like to thank all of you who are here in person and all of you who've joined online. I really appreciate you you joining us. So thank you so much. Let's celebrate. Thank you.
Okay, we do have just a few minutes if there's any burning questions from the audience. Anybody? We're not necessarily expecting questions at inaugural, but if there was any burning questions, okay. I have the privilege of expressing our thanks back to Karin for her excellent lecture today. My name's Jem Hebden, and I was head of department at the time that we appointed Karin to a lectureship. And to this day, I still say to my early career researchers that whenever you have an interview, you should do what Karin did. Karin's interview was a model on how to be an interviewee. I think the panel felt more interviewed by Karin than Karin felt interviewed by us. But anyway, it was amazing. And it was for Karin, it was about her meticulousness, her preparation, her attention to detail. And these qualities which were evident in that interview have been evident in spades ever since, in her contributions to the department, in this talk today. I think you can also see in her talk why she's had these commendations for her teaching. And she is an outstanding teacher. And we must give a lot of credit, of course, to her A-level physics teacher, of course, for that. But nevertheless, she's learnt a lot. And she's passed on those skills to a lot of our students, including those who are probably MRI clinicians and physicists today. Thanks to Karin. So she's a great communicator, and we've really seen that today. And her talk was very entertaining, very insightful, and I think we all enjoyed it. And so I think we'll put our hands together one more time to express our thanks for a fantastic talk.